Hi, very good morning. So I need to raise my voice. So good morning. So today we'll be having this image-based discussion pertaining to this hexagon shape, particularly the instruments which are used Dharma Materium, which are applied while performing extractions, right? So we'll first focus on various instruments first, and later we'll try and go ahead with various extraction forceps and also different types of elevators we have. So almost we have 40 to 50 images first, so we'll try to cover them, and if time constraints are not there, then we can proceed, or else we'll have another session evening or some other day, right? So once again, a very good morning. Right. So we'll start with our today's discussion. Once again, a very good morning, right? So first of all, we'll just have, rather than MCQs, we'll just try to have these images, and then we'll have a brief description of the religions given pertaining to these images, right? So we'll start with the first one. So obviously it's easy to identify these images, right? So the most commonly used, we have these handles, bar and part cut blades, as well as handles, right? So as you can see on the top, this is handle number 7. So handle number 7 with a BP blade, right? So scalpels, these are scalpels which are composed of handle and sharp disposable blade. We have a number 7 handle here and a number 15 blade. So we have different numbering blades, right? We have we have this 10 size, we have this 15 size, 12 size, 11 size. We have different sizes of blades and we have different shapes also. We'll discuss that next. So this is a number 7 handle with a 15 size blade. And also you can see this is the most commonly used, I guess. We use this in prosthodontics also, right? Yeah. So this is a number 7, which is comparatively longer. So handles also, we do have numbers. Number 7 handle, whereas this is number 3 handle. Number 3 handle, but the blade is almost the same. It's a 15 size BP blade, right? So scalpels composed of handle and sharp disposable blade. Scalpel number 7 handle. The top one shows 7 handle with 15 blade, whereas the bottom one shows the same blade with number 3 handle, right? And we have, as I said, different sizes and different shapes of these blades, right? So as you can see, this is number 3 handle, as we have seen in the previous image. And along with that, we have different sized and different shaped blades. So we can remember this in one particular manner. As you can see, we'll just go through the numbers first, and then we'll discuss how to remember the shapes and the corresponding numbers easily. So middle left, this is number 15, which we have seen previously. This is beak shaped, this is number 12, and this is almost gun shaped. So this is 11, and this is having a different shape, which is a bulkier one comparatively, which we used to remove plaster and all in our preclinical. So this is number 10. Right, so this resembles more or less the shape of the knife which a butcher has. Like when you go to a butcher shop, you have this shape, particular shape, where he cuts all the pieces of your meat, right? So you can just remember it in one particular fashion. Assume that you have gone to a meat shop at 10 o'clock in the morning, and by 11 o'clock he uses a gun to shoot the hen or a goat, and by 12 o'clock there is a fall of beak of that particular animal. So we have hen, we have a beak, right? So the beak comes off because he has shot with a gun. So if you can remember this simple line, so 10 o'clock, so this, based on this, you can easily identify the shape of a blade. So 10 o'clock means you've gone to a butcher shop, so obviously it resembles the butcher's knife, right? So 11 o'clock, he has shot with a gun, resembles the shape of a gun. And 12 o'clock, so there is falling beak, so beak shaped, big shaped blade, right? So this is the smallest one possible. So we have number 15, as we've seen in the previous image, right? So middle left is number 15, middle right, so this is big shaped number 12, and lower left gun shaped, that is 11, and lower right 10 shaped butcher's knife, right? So these are some of the blades, and they can of course ask you to identify the blade based on its shape, right? So as you have seen in the previous image, this long handle is number 9 handle, number 7 handle, whereas the shorter handle comparatively is number 3, to which number 15 blade is attached, right? And also, as we have discussed, we have different size blades, right? We have 15 size blade, and this is beak shaped 12 size. This is a gun shaped, something like that, so 11 size blade, and this is 10 size blade, right? Once again, before we conclude, I'll summarize once again all this. So before that, we'll just proceed into further discussion, right? So we'll have next periodic elevator. So first of all, are you able to see these images clearly, or do you want me to make any modifications with respect to the display? Yes, Shirish, Saida, Abhishek, Megha, Gina. Yeah, Tanu, good morning. Yes, Rohit Bhai, very good morning. Good morning, Ramesh. Yes, Saida. Okay. Okay, Abhishek. Right. So also, I think we discussed these shapes in one of the, live sessions also, if you remember. So try to remember these shapes based on your own format, right? You can use your own mnemonic, or as I said, I felt this comparatively easy since this resembles the shape of a butcher and moreover it's bulky, right? So 10 o'clock, I've gone to a butcher's shop, and 11 o'clock, he uses a gun to shoot a hen, and at 12 o'clock, so 10, 11 and 12, 12 o'clock, the beak falls down, right? So obviously the smaller one is 15, right? So that's how I remember these shapes of the BP plates. Might sound funny, but it has to be funny. Only then you can remember it for a longer time. So the way in which you handle a BP plate, so this is normal pin grasp to have better control, and also the blade has to be activated by initiating the movements at the wrist. This is very important. Rather than initiating the movement in the forearm, the movements have to be initiated while making incisions. We have already discussed this during our live sessions on principles of incisions, right? So one of the principles is that we need to initiate the movement at the level of wrist to have precise control over the incision, right? So scalpel held in pin grasp to allow maximum control. Yeah, next we'll see some of the elevators. So can you identify this elevator? Yes, Abhishek. Yeah, Tanu, Saida, Gina, Ramesh. Hi, Lakshmi. Good morning. So, periosteal elevator. So, we have different types of periosteal elevators, and as I said, this is a routine periosteal elevator which we use in our specialty. So, this is number 9 Molt's periosteal elevator, MOLT, Molt, Molt periosteal elevator. It's number 9 Molt's periosteal elevator, which is commonly used in oral surgery, right? Number 9 Molt periosteal elevator. And what about this? You might have seen all these in your department or in a clinic where you have this entire armamentarium. So even this is a periosteal elevator, but it's a single-ended periosteal elevator, Molt's periosteal elevator, which is single-ended, as you can see there, right? So a single-ended Molt periosteal elevator with a sharp round end may be used to elevate mucoperiosteum, right? So it's a single-ended Molt's periosteal elevator. And this is also a periosteal elevator. Double-ended Molt's periosteal elevator with a small end and a large end to provide the surgeon the appropriate size to end this specific task. So depending upon the amount of tissue that has to be removed or to amount of tissue that has to be reflected. So we have different sizes, a smaller end and a larger end, right? So this is also a double-ended periosteal elevator. The same with a different orientation, right? So this is number 9 Molt's periosteal elevator, which is commonly used in oral surgery for reflecting mucoperiosteum. And then we have a single-ended Molt's periosteal elevator, double-ended Molt's periosteal elevator. right? The same. And this is also a periostal elevator, but this is a number one Woodson periostal elevator, WOODSON. Number one Woodson periostal elevator, which is used to loosen soft tissue from teeth before extraction, right? So this is number one Woodson periostal elevator. If you want, I'll just zoom in so that you can appreciate the difference between the normal one and this Woodson periostal elevator. You have a small spoon shaped outline over there. So it's number one Woodson periostal elevator. Anyways, I'll share all these images in our WhatsApp update group once we complete our discussion, right? So that when you're again going through this video later, you can just correlate what you're seeing and what you're listening. So this is a common instrument again we use in oral surgical procedures. Can you identify this? Yeah. Hi, Venice. Good morning. I'm sure she slept again. Yeah. Identify this instrument. Langerbach retractor, tongue retractor. Tongue retractor, we have one specific image again. Yeah, Sajid, it's a smart answer. Yes, it's a retractor. So it is a tissue retractor or retraction, helps in retraction of soft tissues, the buccal mucosa, tongue, not tongue specifically. But it's nothing but Austin's retractor. Austin retractor is a right angle retractor that can be used to retract cheek, of course tongue and flaps. We have a specific retractor which is designed for retracting tongue, which we'll discuss later, right? So this is Austin retractor, AUSTIN, Austin retractor that can be used to retract cheek, flaps, tongue, etc. And then this is right angle, right? So it's right angle. We have an offset or a retractor which is having a different angulation other than 90. So this is an offset retractor and this is called as Minnesota retractor. Minnesota, M-I-N-N-E-S-O-T-A. So Minnesota retractor is an offset retractor used for retraction of cheeks and flaps. So this is Austin's retractor. And this is Minnesota retractor. So almost shape of M, something like that, Minnesota. Yeah. Now, so these two we have discussed just now. So let me just zoom in so that you can go through them once again, right? And identify them. I'll leave out the top one, which is very much different. These two we have discussed just now. See if you can identify them now. I'll just wait for a few seconds so that these things will go. Just try identifying the top one and bottom one. Just now we have discussed about these images, right? I hope you can see them clearly, right? Just go ahead and just give me 1 minute, right? I'll be back. Thank you. Yeah, so the bottom one is the moles, number 9 moles periostic elevator, which is commonly used, right? Which we're all familiar with. The top one we have discussed just now. So that this is number 1 Woodson's periostic elevator. So to have that differentiation, they have given this image, right? So this is number 1 Woodson's periostic elevator, and the bottom one is number 9 moles periostic elevator. And the topmost one, which is comparatively broad, right? So this is also a periostic elevator, and it's called as Selden retractor. Selden retractor, S-E-L-D-I-N, Selden. Selden retractor, which is often used, it's a broader instrument that's used for better retraction and increased visualization, right? So this is Selden retractor, and this is number 1 Woodson's periostic elevator, and we have number 9 Moltz periostic elevator, which is a common one to be used in our oral surgery, right? Next. So identify this instrument. Hi Ashina, a very good morning. Aishwarya, yeah. Hi Aishwarya, good morning. Yes, it's Selden. Good. See, just can't blame college, right? See, it's unprofessional to blame our college now. Yeah, there are many things which we need to learn by ourselves, and in fact, Bernice, you should be thankful in that case to your college, because you're learning it now by yourself, which will have greater reinforcement. If someone teaches you, it's not really that effective, in my opinion. But once we learn it by ourselves, then it's much more, it has much more impact on learning, isn't it? Yeah, yes, Aishwarya. Hope Aishwarya is not having, how did I identify this instrument, Aishwarya? Okay, cheek retractor and all we have seen previously, right? Austin is a retractor. See, I'll just zoom in so that you'll understand the purpose. So Abhishek is smart. Smart enough to say that it's some kind of retractor, but don't know for what it's used. So can you see some irregularities here? Some grooves. So these grooves are added up to have better retention, right? So this is mainly used for retracting tongue. So it's a tongue retractor. It's a Wielder retractor. Yes, Aishwarya, you're right. It starts with W. Wielder. W-E-I-D-E-R. Wielder retractor. It's a Wielder retractor. It's a large one which is designed to retract tongue. The serrated surface helps to engage the tongue so that it can be held securely. Wielder. W-E-I-D-E-R. Wielder retractor. So the same which is in action. So as you can see, Wielder retractor used for retracting tongue, and we have Austin's retractor which is used for retracting the cheeks or even a flap or even tongue. Tongue can be reflected or retracted using Austin's. Okay, Aishwarya posted in oral surgery currently. Good. Then you must be knowing all these instruments then. Let's see. Yeah. Hope you can see them. Yeah. Right. So identify this pair of instruments. Yeah. Wielder. W-E-I-D-E-R. Wielder retractor. Yeah, I hope you can see them now. So these are straight, you have these locking handles also here. It's So these are hemostats. These are striate hemostats, and also we have the angulation curved hemostats. Hemostat, striate hemostat, and this is a curved hemostat. Right? So hemostat will have parallel grooves. Usually we use this the same instrument like even for as a needle holder, but it shouldn't be done. So we'll just go through the morphology of the working and also in the next image. So this is a curved hemostat. So normal hemostat and a curved hemostat. And so identify this instrument. I mean, the working end is not so clear. We have a separate image to depict the working end. Okay. It's toothed. Now it's not so clear, but it's toothed. We have these teeth here. Yeah, tissue holding forceps, yes, very good. So it's a small delicate adson, A-D-S-O-N, adson tissue holding forceps to gently stabilize soft tissue for suturing or for dissection. So this is adson's tissue forceps, right? Adson tissue forceps. And we have another forceps here, which is comparatively longer, right? So this is stilis picup, S-T-I-L-L-I-E-S, stilis picup, which is longer than adson picup or tissue holding forceps, and is used to handle tissue in the most posterior aspect of the mouth. So the previous one is adson, and this is stilis. S-T-I-L-L-I-E-S, stilis picup, or stilis tissue holding forceps, which is used because of this longer length. I mean, it's designed to be used in the posterior region of oral cavity. So this is nothing but a locking tweezer. It's a tweezer, right? We have a locking handle here. So this is a locking tweezer, also called as college pliers. C-O-L-L-E-G, college pliers, which is used for picking small objects in the mouth or from the tray, mayo tray stand. So this is adson pickup or adson tissue holding forceps, and this is stilis tissue holding forceps, right? And this is a normal locking tweezer. So I'll just zoom into this image. So identify this instrument. You can see the working end. I'll just show you the same instrument, in a different format. So they have given two or three representations for the same image. So the same instrument here on the left, which I have shown. So the same instrument being represented in this image also. So this is adson tissue holding forceps. So one of you asked me whether it's toothed or not, right? You can see the teeth here. Let me just zoom in. So adson's tissue holding forceps, where you have the teeth, and this is, we are all familiar with this forceps which we are discussing now, Allis forceps. So Allis tissue holding forceps, A-L-L-I-S, Allis. Allis tissue forceps, useful for grasping and holding tissue that will be excised. So this is Allis forceps, where you have multiple teeth. As you can see, we have multiple teeth. Compared to adson tissue holding forceps, right? So this is Alice tissue holding forceps. So identify this instrument. It appears like a tweezer, but it's not. We do not have any sharp margins, but we have serrations, and the function of this is, I mean, it can be used for picking up any tissues or any hard and soft tissues, right? So this is Russian forceps. Russian tissue forceps are round ended pickups. You can see the round ended margins here. Let me just zoom in. So you can see the round ended margins, right? So this is a Russian pickup or Russian tissue holding forceps. You want some entertainment? By mistake, I've pressed exit button. I'm really sorry. So AdSense, Alice, Russian forceps, yeah. Now, so this is, I mean, we're all familiar with this, identify this. By the way, it's not an orthodontic plier. So the same instrument in a zoomed in manner. So identify this instrument. Yeah, Bernice, right on target. Yes, Gina, Jinglala, life ko Jinglala, okay. Right. Yeah, it's a bone Rongeur, right? So Rongeurs are bone cutting forceps that have spring-loaded handles. So we have end cutting and side cutting blades as well, right? Bone Rongeurs. Bone cutting instruments. Right. So comparatively easy to identify. We see carpenters using them as well. So identify this set of instruments. Yes, Ramesh, Abhishek. Yeah. Gina, Bernice, Ashina, Yathanu, Naishwaryo, Saida. Right. So these are chisel and hammer, right? Hammer, mallet. Mallet, we call this mallet. So mallet and chisel used for cutting hard tissues, but the problem is there can be delivery of uncontrolled force. So surgical chisel and mallet used for removing bone and also for sectioning teeth. So we have different design of chisels, right? So as you can see from the top to bottom, we have uni bevel, and you have this uni bevel which is curved, and then you have this bi-bevel chisel. The same we'll just go through in a more detailed manner. As you can see here, I hope it's clear. So I'll have to zoom in, I guess. I'm sorry again.
Match kato. Ye machi to bata le, lekin asli kata to bhi baki hai.
I'm not used to using this remote, so getting confused. So chisels, we have different chisels, uni bevel, bi bevel, and also we have curved uni bevel chisel, right? Since it's weekend, the television, the screen is not accepting to play any academic related videos. It's asking us to have, it's advising us to have some entertainment as it's weekend. Yeah, here you go. You have different shapes. So we have this, you can see, we have this curvature, right? This curvature, I hope it's evident. So you can see two bevels here, right? The one here, the one here. So this is a bi-bevel chisel and this is a uni-bevel chisel. This is also a uni-bevel chisel which is curved. So different orientation, different shapes of chisels. So bi-bevel, uni-bevel which is straight or normal, uni-bevel which is curved, right? So we have surgical chisel and mallet, chisels and mallet, right? So used for cutting bones and also for sectioning teeth. So I hope you can identify that. So identify the following instrument, which is used for removing or for smoothening sharp margins on a bone. So Abhishek, you said it's a hammer. Good. Yeah. Yes, Lakshmi, Aishwarya, Abhishek, Gina, Ashina, Tanu, Pooja. Hi, Pooja. Yeah, it's a bone file, right? And moreover, the most important thing, which I still remember, which was told during our posting, is it has to be used only in pull motion. Right, so the blades are they're angled in such a way that it can be activated only with pull motion rather than push motion. Right, so it's a double-ended bone file which is used for smoothening small sharp edges or spicules of bone. The teeth of bone file are effective only in pull stroke. Right, only in pull stroke. So this is a bone file. Right, so this is a normal. It seems like a rocket for you. Does it seem like a rocket? So identify this instrument. Right, this is Nasser's property, you say. So this is a straight micromotor handpiece, right? We have various burrs, attached burrs used for bone cutting. So typical moderate speed, high torque, sterilizable handpiece with a burr. I'll just zoom in. They mentioned this as 703 burr. I'm not sure it's so clear, right? It's 703 bar, straight handpiece with 703 bar. Right. So identify this instrument, which is used for scooping out any soft tissues or used for debriding. Exactly, it's a curette, it's a periapical curette which is used for removing soft tissues. It's a double-ended instrument with a spoon-shaped ends. As you can see, we have spoon-shaped ends. So it's a double-ended instrument, it's a periapical curette used for removing soft tissue from the bony defects, right? And identify this next instrument and let me know whether it's a hemostat or a needle holder. And how do you differentiate between the two? Is it a hemostat or is it a needle holder? Yes, Saida, it looks like a spoon excavator, but spoon excavator is a minute version of the same. It's even more tiny, but this periapical curette, it has comparatively larger ends. Hi Mohammed, good morning. Abhishek, you'll check this by opening. Even without opening, you can identify this. So needle holders, they have shorter ends, whereas hemostats, if you observe, they have comparatively longer ends, longer working ends, right? And also you have longer shank design, longer shank or longer handle comparatively, right? So needle holder has a locking handle and a short stout beak. So it has a longer handle and a shorter stouter beak. So you have this working end which is very much shorter compared to the hemostat, right? And you can differentiate between the two based on this, right? As you can see, now tell me which one is hemostat and which one is a needle holder. The top one and the bottom one. Exactly, Zina. Good. We differentiate that by serrations. So as we discussed, in case of hemostat, once we open it, as Abhishek rightly said, once you open it, you have parallel serrations, parallel grooves, then that's a hemostat. Whereas if you have this crisscross kind of grooves for increased retention, that's a needle holder. Good. So bottom artery forceps, hemostat or is it a needle holder? Yes, as we discussed previously. So based on the length of the beak or based on the length of the working end, you can see if it's longer, it's hemostat. For in case of this needle holder, we have a short and stout beak as mentioned in the description, right? So this is one way of identifying. The other way, the best way. So once you open it, I hope you can see that clearly. Or let me just zoom in once. So which one is a hemostat and which one is a needle holder, left and right? The left one and the right one. See, when you have these parallel serrations, you can't hold a needle in a stabilized manner with parallel serrations. So to have better retention over the needle, we have this crisscrossed kind of serrations, right? If you observe the platform of a bus or in a train where you have these kind of orientations, crisscross orientations for added retention, right? So hemostat has parallel grooves that do not allow a firm grip on the needle. So when you have parallel grooves, it cannot be used for needle holding. It's a hemostat, whereas the left one with crisscross striations and all, this is a needle holder for enhanced retention, right? The face of the short beak, the face of the short beak is cross-hatched to ensure positive grip on the needle, right? So the right one is hemostat, the left one is a needle holder. Okay. The top one is a hemostat, the bottom one is a needle holder based on length of the beaks. Then this is how you handle a needle holder, where you can see a longer handle with a short beak, right? We use a thumb and middle finger to insert into these rings and thumb and ring finger into the rings and index and middle fingers to orient the direction of the needle holders, right? So the thumb and ring fingers are inserted into the rings. The same. Right. Then we have these suture needles and we have specific names and numbers for these suture needles. That's the reason why I'm discussing them also. So you have different sizes, right? As you can see, the top one is a smaller one, the bottom one seems to be comparatively a larger one. So we have some numberings given here. So top one is P3, P, alphabet P, P3. This is P3. The middle one is F52, and the bottom one is iPhone X, X1. Okay, by the way, you need not really remember these names and all, it will be even more confusing, right? So this is a suture needle, so we have different numbers given to them. This is P3 and this is F52 and this is X1. Okay, so only for sake of completion I'm just adding up these images. You really need not worry. So needle holder, we have this triangular cross section. The cutting needles, they'll have triangular cross section for easy passage into the tissues, right? So we have eyes at the end which can be used to insert the suture material, right? Classification of what you mean to say, the numbers P3, these X1 and all, I'm not sure, Aishwarya. And the position where you hold the needle is very important. As you can see here in this image, the needle is being held with a needle holder at the junction of anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3, as you can see. So this is the anterior 2/3, right? And this is the posterior 1/3, almost at the junction behind the posterior 2/3 of the needle. So needle holder grasps the curved needle 2/3 of the distance from the tip of the needle, almost 2/3 the distance from the tip of the needle, right? Yeah, and then we have these scissors, tissue cutting scissors. So suture scissors, okay, I'm sorry, there are suture scissors and also we have tissue cutting. Yeah, we have soft tissue scissors also, we'll just go through them later. But these are suture scissors or suture cutting scissors which have long blades as well as short blades. Blades may be angled lightly in either of two directions, right? So suture scissors. And suture scissors should be held in same fashion as that of needle holder. It's fine. These are called as suture scissors, right? And we have these soft tissue scissors next. So soft tissue scissors, they're of two designs. The top one, we have small sharp pointed scissors. The small sharp pointed scissors. And the bottom one, Metzenbaum scissors, which are longer, delicate, blunt nosed scissors. I'll just type out the name because it's really very difficult to pronounce. It's Metzenbaum. So I just typed out, so it's Metzenbaum. I'm sorry, I've given the wrong spelling. Yeah, Metzenbaum scissor, the bottom one, which is a blunt nose. We have this blunt end, whereas the sharp one is the normal tissue cutting scissor, right? This, I hope you can easily identify, right? We have a name here. Yeah, there is a name here. So identify this device. It looks like a hut for you.
Okay.
See, whenever you get a question pertaining to this image-based question asking identify the instrument, and you have the option none of the above, please don't choose none of the above, saying that it looks like a hut, right? Yeah, it's a mouth prop. I'm sorry, mouth prop, bite blocks. We have the serrations, I mean the grooves, which are used for engaging the teeth, right? We're just nearing to completion. Yeah. So this is a side action or mold mouth prop. Side action or mold mouth prop. So it's also a mouth prop, but it has a name, mold, M-O-L-T. So you have this mold periosteal elevator, so mold mouth prop, which can be used to open the patient's mouth when the patient is unable to cooperate, especially during sedation, right? So bite blocks, conscious patients, we use for conscious patients. This is used mold's mouth prop when the patient is on sedation, right? To facilitate mouth opening again. So this is side action or mold mouth prop. And this is a suction device which you're all familiar with. So it's a typical surgical suction. And this is called as Fraser suction. And we have this tiny needle which is used for unclogging. If at all there is any soft tissue debris when there is clogging, then it's this small needle is used for unclogging this Fraser suction tip. F-R-A-S-E-R. This is Fraser suction tip. And then finally we have this transfer forceps, which are comparatively bulky, right? So these are used for transferring any instruments, sterilized instruments to the working area, or once the instruments are used to the cleaning area, right? So transfer forceps are used to move sterile instruments from one sterile area to another. They're used for moving sterile instruments, and these forceps are sturdy enough to move instruments without fear of losing grip. Transfer forceps can also be used to handle small items such as anesthetic cartridges. We don't use cartridges here, however, I mean it's a common practice over there. And finally, so this is transfer forceps, and this is, so identify this instrument. Yeah, that needle is for unclogging. Yeah, this is a towel clip, right? Good. For securing the drapes. So towel clip used to hold the drapes in position. The sharp points penetrate the towels and locking handles. We have locking handles and the sharp points which penetrate the drapes. So towel clamps or towel clips with non-penetrating action are also available. And finally, we have these irrigation devices. We have this self-locked, we call this as self-loaded. I'm sorry, spring-loaded. So the top one is bulb or regular syringe, which is used for carrying the irrigation solution, appears to be like a chip blower, but it is not. The second one, B, shows the regular syringe again. So this is the bulb syringe, and this is a regular syringe, and this is a spring-loaded syringe. The self-loaded syringe is spring-loaded to allow filling simply by releasing the plunger. So these are some of the irrigation devices for irrigating any bony cavities or the area of operation once the procedure is before suturing and all, right? After debridement procedures. So we'll just change chip blower. Yeah, appears to be like a chip blower, but you can see there is some difference here. The nozzle end So we'll once again go through all the images at once, final, and then we'll conclude the session, right? Yeah, so I hope you can see that, right? So these are scalpels with handle and blade. So the top one is number 7 handle with 15 size blade, and the bottom one is number 3 handle with again 15 size blade, right? Next, we have different designs of blade. So this is a number 3 handle, we have 15 size blade, and as I said, 10 o'clock I have gone to a butcher shop. So this is number 10. 11 o'clock he has taken his gun and he has shot a hen, and 12 o'clock its beak has fallen, right? So 10, 11 and 12. So 10, so this is number 10 and this is gun shaped number 11 and this is beak shaped number 12 and this is a smaller one, number 15 blade. So this is normal pin grasp, so normal pin grasp for holding your scalpel. So this is number 9 Moltz periosteal elevator, commonly used in oral surgery. A single ended Moltz periosteal elevator, a double ended Moltz periosteal elevator, the same. Double ended Moltz periosteal elevator. And this is a smaller one compared to the Moltz periosteal elevator. And this is number 1 Woodson periosteal elevator. Number 1 Woodson periosteal elevator. Austin's retractor, retracting cheek, tongue, flaps. So Austin's retractor, it is right angled, whereas offset angle other than 90, this is Minnesota retractor, Minnesota. And this is number 1 Woodson periosteal elevator, number 9 Moltz periosteal elevator, and this is a wider periosteal elevator which is called as Seldin. Seldin, it is seldom used for retraction, maybe it's called as Seldin. Seldin, Seldin retractor, which has a broader ends, better visualization and better retraction. They haven't mentioned it as better retraction, but broader retraction and increased visualization, broader retraction. So this is Seldin's retractor. And this is a tongue retractor called as Weider retractor, W-E-I-D-E-R, Weider retractor. So the same in action, this is Austin's and this is Weider retractor. And these are your hemostats, which you readily identify with a locking handles and a longer working ends with parallel serrations on the working portion. And this is a curved hemostat. And this is Aldin tissue pickup or Aldin tissue holding forceps. I said Aldin, I'm sorry, it's Adson. Adson, A-D-S-O-N. Adson tissue pickup or Adson tissue holding forceps. A-D-S-O-N, Adson. And this is a locking tweezer. And this is a longer version of the previous one, which is called as Stilles. Adson tissue pickup. And this is a Stilles tissue pickup, the same but with a longer handle, right? S-T-I-L-L-I-E-S, Stilles pickup. Appears like a towel clip, but it's not a towel clip. So this is Alice tissue holding forceps. So Alice tissue holding forceps for holding up tissues before excision, and this is your Adson tissue holding forceps, Adson pickup. And you have tissue pickup, which is broader, which has this concave, not concave, but rounded margins at the end. This is Russian forceps. So Russian tissue holding forceps with round ended pickups, right? Bone Reuinger, Bone Reuinger, Rongers, Bone Reuinger. So according to Abhishek, this is hammer and chisel, mallet and chisel. So chisels, we have different angulations, so we have different bevels. We'll just go through them now. So it's a single bevel or uni bevel, curved, uni bevel, normal stride, and then you have bi-bevel. And you have this bone file with parallel serrations, which can be activated in pull motion. It's a double-ended instrument. And this is a high torque, moderate speed handpiece with 703 bar. If I'm not wrong, it's mentioned as 703. You need not worry about that, okay? Just leave it. And this is your macro version of spoon excavator. This is curet, periapical curet. It's a double-ended instrument, spoon-shaped instrument for removing soft tissue from the bony defects. And you have a needle holder with a long handle, a locking handle, and a short, stout beak. And to differentiate a hemostat from a needle holder, we have this hemostat with a longer beak or longer working end, and a shorter, stouter beak in case of needle holder. And based on the working area, you have crisscross striations in case of needle holder for better grip. If you have parallel serrations, you can try with that, you'll understand. I tried previously using this hemostat as a needle holder. It didn't really work. It gets, it doesn't really engage the needle holder efficiently. The needle holder gets falls into these grooves and you'll not have the right orientation. So you have parallel serrations in case of hemostat, and this is your needle holder. The way in which you handle your needle holder. So different needles, and we have some numbers like P3, F52 and X1. This is P3, this is X52 and this is X1. P3, F52, X1. You can just leave it, okay? And then you have suture scissors. Okay, these are eyes, right? Yeah, holding almost 2/3 from the tip of the needle. And you have these suture scissors, which have long blades or long handles, I'm sorry, long handles and short blades. Very long handles and short blades. Soft tissue scissors. So these are your soft tissue scissors. As you can see, we have long blades comparatively, right? So that's how you can differentiate soft tissue scissors from suture scissors. Suture scissors, you have long handles and a very, very short working area or blade. But soft tissue scissors, you can see the length of the working portion, right? And this is called as, it has some different name altogether, Metzenbaum, M-E-T-Z-E-N-B-A-U-M, Metzenbaum scissor, which has a blunt end, by the way. And the next one is a mouth prop or bite block for adults. And this is mold mouth prop or side action mouth prop. It's a mouth prop which is called as side action or molds mouth prop. So suction devices. The bottom one is Fraser, F-R-A-S-E-R, Fraser suction tip. And you have these transfer forceps, which are bulky comparatively. And finally, you have these double clips and irrigation devices, bulb, syringe, and self-loaded, spring-loaded syringes. Right? So this completes most of our instruments except for the elevators and extraction forceps. We still have elevators and extraction forceps to be covered. It's almost 6:50. 1 hour. right? So we'll try doing that in a separate session, right? So that to avoid confusion. And I hope all the instruments which we discussed are clear for you. So we have few names which we are not so familiar with. You just try to focus on those four or five images that would complete off your topic, right? So you have any questions, you can drop them or you can mail us at proudtobedentist@gmail.com. At least you're saying it's a chip blower. During our childhood days, we used to have these autos. We used to have this horn, right? Doesn't it resemble that way? Yeah, right. Okay then. Have a great day. See you all again tomorrow if possible. If possible, today or tomorrow morning. But we're going to have one general session, right? So tomorrow evening. Because of time constraints, if I'm unable to do it, we'll do it either on Sunday. Anyways, I'll just intimate you via mail or WhatsApp, right? So have a great day. Have a happy weekend and enjoy your day, right? Bye. All the best.